The Kings River Experimental Watershed, also known as CREW, is the only long-term study in the Southern Sierra looking at forest management practices on the watersheds.
And these healthy watersheds are really important because that's what drives our agricultural system in the valley. So there is a lot of watershed concerns right now, given the tree mortality that we have. And we think that the Kings River watershed will help answer some of those questions about water availability and those changes before and after our treatments.
The Kings River Experimental Watersheds provides us the opportunity to compare 8 small watersheds in the headwaters of the Kings River. And that's an especially powerful design because they allow us to design an experiment on the landscape and be able to control the factors that are changing.
So CREW wanted to answer 3 things: to characterize the variability in the watersheds, to look at how forest management practices, especially the thinning and the burning, affects the watershed, and lastly, to address the changing climate on the watershed.
We're looking at physical, chemical, and biological parameters. The forests in the Sierra Nevada are not in especially good condition because of several factors: fire suppression for many years, air pollution, and now a changing climate.
The Kings River Experimental Watersheds have chosen headwater streams. So these are streams at the very top tributaries, the highest elevation of their streams. And this is important because it eliminates variables of human-induced causes and inputs.
CREW is broken up into 2 sites. We have an upper elevation site known as Bull Creek Site, and we have a lower elevation site called Providence Creek Site.
The CREW Bull is at 8,000 feet in elevation. It gets different amount of snow and has a longer snowpack generally than what we've had down in the CREW Providence part of it, and you'll be able to compare those watersheds, especially the difference in the elevations.
Within those 2 sites, we have 4 watersheds with different treatments. So we have a control where no treatment happened. We had a thin only, a burn only, and one that had both treatments performed.
And we spent a lot of time trying to decide what those treatments should look like, exactly which watersheds would receive which treatments, which ones would be the controls. And so we went through a lot of analysis along with lead researchers to figure out the intensity of the treatments, and then what would be considered a typical treatment for us.
The sites that we're working in are mixed conifer, and they would have had fires, low intensity fires in them, every 12 to 15 years. And we've suppressed fire for over 100 years on these sites. And so the sites are not functioning the same way they would have.
So I think one of the questions we'll be able to answer through it in the future is how water moves through a system, given the densities that we've had, pre-treatments versus post-treatments, once all the fire treatments are in place, is to see the changes in percolation and soil movement to be able to address the health of the watersheds themselves.
Many people don't realize that the Sierra Nevada, especially in the southern Sierra Nevada, receives a large amount of air pollution. They often think it's just in the valleys. We have been studying the air quality along with stream water quality to better understand the complete cycle.
What the data are showing us currently is that the trees and the soil microbes are filtering out a lot of the pollution that we find up here in the Kings River.
In terms of maintaining trees on the landscape, we're going through a very devastating time of the loss of forest structure over hundreds of thousands of acres in the Southern Sierras. And so those stressors on the forest, in particular pine species, are devastating. What can I say? We're losing millions, tens of millions of trees from the forest right now.
So in 2000, the project was started, but data collection started in 2003. And so from 2003 to 2011, we had pre-drought data as well as pre-treatment data. And then in 2012 to 2016 now, we've been in this drought. And so we're able to look at how the drought has been affecting tree mortality, but tree mortality is a bigger issue because it's being caused by the lack of water, air pollution, and the bark beetles. So we're really able to focus on what's happening and what's going on.
Having this fundamental research for us in the Southern Sierras gives us a huge leg up in knowing what's best and how to treat the forest in the best way.